Hey everyone, I am Asma, a junior scientist at the ENO Delft. Today I will present the results of a project that I did before Corona time at Chalmers University of Technology, which is about weld residual stress distribution. Weld was introduced in the late of the 30s and the early of the 40s with the purpose to replace bolt and riveted connections. Since then, new welding technology has been developed, such as metal inert guards, metal active guards, and lately laser welding was increased a lot. Weld is heat and tensile process that introduces change in the material property and microstructure, such as the hardness and the yield strength of the material. Also, weld introduces weld defects, micro cracks and inclusions at the welded area, and introduces also stress concentration and residual stresses at both weld toe and root. All of these effects are detrimental for the fatigue life and the performance of the as-welded structures. Also, all these effects are highly dependent on the weld parameters, I mean in the weld process. The welding speed, the voltage, the wire size, how did we weld the structure, I mean. It was stated in the literature that microcracks and residual stresses are the most important parameters that affect the performance of the as-welded structures. In this presentation, I will focus on the residual stresses, or to be more specific, on the weld residual stresses at the weld toe. It was stated in the literature that welding, in most cases, weld introduce tensile residual stress at the surface, but in few studies, they stated that weld could also introduce compressive residual stresses at the surface. In order to characterize the weld residual stress distribution at the weld toe in the thickness direction, we define three parameters. The first parameter is the magnitude of the residual stress at the surface. The second parameter is the maximum magnitude of the residuals of the subsurface residual stress. And the third parameter is the depth of the maximum subsurface residual stress. Defining this or characterizing these three parameters, we could estimate the shape of the residual stress at the weld toe in the depth direction. If we move to the next slide, as I mentioned in the introduction, that within this project we collected data from literature and we tried to categorize it in cases where we have tensile residual stress at the surface and in cases where we have compressive residual stress at the surface. And always I am talking about weld residual stress. And using the three defined parameters, which are the magnitude of the weld residual stress at the surface, the maximum subsurface residual stress, and the depth of the maximum subsurface residual stress, we try to plot the shapes of the residual stresses at the weld toe through the thickness direction. And here you see the shape of the tensile residual stresses at the weld toe through the thickness direction. And here you see the case where we have compressive residual stress at the surface. The first thing that someone could detect is that we have a lot of data in case where we have tensile residual stress at the surface in comparison with compressive residual stress at the surface. This is the first detection, but Also, what we can say that we collected more data for case where we have tensile residual stress at the surface, but unfortunately they don't give the whole information about the shape of the in-depth residual stresses. So we were limited to study only the cases where they give the shape of the subsurface, or the case where they studied or measured the residual stresses in the depth direction. So, to characterize the shape of the residual stresses, we defined three parameters and we collected data from the literature. So, using these two informations, we did the probabilistic analysis of the collected data and we tried to define the shape of the residual stresses regardless the welded steel and regardless the plate thickness. And doing this, we normalized the magnitude of the residual stresses by the yield strength of the steel, and we normalized the depth of the maximum subsurface residual stresses by the plate thickness. Doing this, in combination with the collected data, we found the following distributions for the three parameters. And as you can see here that the parameters are defined regardless the yield strength of the material. So always we try to define the mean and the standard deviation regardless the yield strength of the material, and we define the maximum depth of the depth of the maximum subsurface residual stress by the plate thickness T here. Same work was done for case where we have tensile residual stress at the surface. Using the collected data, we defined the three parameters to characterize the shape of the residual stresses. And always we defined these shapes regardless the strength of the material and regardless the T, which is the plate thickness. The following figure summarizes both cases. Case where we have tensile residual stress at the surface and case where we have compressive residual stress at the surface. The values that you see here are the mean of the distribution that we characterized, and Fy is the yield strength of the material, Te thickness is the plate thickness here. So the shapes here are defined regardless the welded steel and regardless the plate thickness. If we move to the next slide. So the previous part of the presentation represent the method and the approach that we use to define the shapes of the weld residual stresses through the thickness direction. Within this project, we did also experimental study, and where we manufactured a transversal attachment and we applied loading cycles until failure. And also, maybe use information that we detected the cracks by strain drop. For randomly selected specimens, we measured the residual stress at the surface, and we found for the four selected specimens that weld introduced compressive residual stresses at the surface. We went a step further and we measured the residual stresses through the thickness direction at the weld toe using hole drilling technique, and we found the following shape. We estimated the residual stresses using the probabilistic analysis, and we found reasonable error between the estimated residual stresses and the measured residual stress. In the introduction, it was stated that weld residual stress has have a effect on the performance of welded structures. Therefore, for this experimental study, we selected 4 randomly specimens and we measured the residual stresses at the surface. And for the 4 selected specimens, we found that weld introduced compressive residual stresses at the surface. We did as we planned. We tested these specimens for fatigue and we find the black dots as you see in this figure. Meanwhile, using the shapes of residual stresses that we defined in slide number 9, compressive and tensile residual stresses at the surface, we estimated the fatigue life for these specimens. And we found that the difference between the fatigue lives where weld introduced compressive residual stress at the surface and tensile residual stress at the surface is 4.5 times. This is the first conclusion. And the second conclusion that using the shape, the mean of the shape of compressive residual stress defined in slide number 9, we found the yellow line here, which is in accordance with the experimental line, which is plotted in black. To conclude, we have 3 main conclusions. The first one, or the first conclusion, the probability that welding process introduced tensile residual stresses is very high in comparison with cases where weld introduced compressive residual stress at the surface. And based on the collected data, we found that the probability that tensile residual stress introduced at the surface is 0.87. These values of probability, of course, can be changed and updated when new measurements is added to this probabilistic analysis. The second conclusion that regardless the welded steel and regardless the plate thickness, the shapes of weld residual stress through the thickness direction, in both cases compressive and tensile residual stress at the surface, are estimated in slide number 9. And the third conclusion that by changing the residual stress or the weld residual stress, the fatigue life changes by 4.5 times. I mean, it increases from tensile, from cases where we have tensile residual stress at the surface to cases where we have compressive residual stress at the surface by 4.5 times the as welded fatigue life. That was the main results that I want to share within this presentation, and thank you very much for your attention and welcome to questions.